Allegheny RiverStone Center for the Arts presents Spark Your Creativity with the Trio Con Brio.
Hello, everyone.
I'm Monique. I'm a professional violinist, a teacher, and a mother of two wonderful musicians who inspire me every day, even before they could really play.
Hi, I'm Isabel. We always had a lot of music at our house, with my dad being the concertmaster of the Pittsburgh Symphony and my mom doing a lot of teaching. I had a lot of time to experiment with different instruments as a kid, and I finally fell in love with the harp at about age 11. Now, I'm a graduating senior heading to college. I'll tell you more about that later.
Hi, I'm Tino. I've been playing piano since I was 5 years old, and for the past year I've been making music videos with my video production company.
We have been a tight-knit trio from the very beginning, traveling to Europe together on concert tours where I presented fun classical music concerts for students. At first, Isabel and Tina would just come with me, visiting schools or sitting on my lap while I signed autographs. But by the time they were 7 years old, they had a part in the show as well.
Between the three of us, there always seems to be somebody practicing at some given time of the day. And that's because we're all either working towards a performance or a project.
So we'd like to invite you into our home so we can share some music and a three-step process that underpins any creative work.
One, finding inspiration.
Two, doing the work.
Three, putting it out there.
We hope you enjoy this video as much as we loved creating it.
Do you know what the chances are that you might be hit by lightning in your lifetime? You're right, they're very, very, very small. Of course, if you wanted to ensure that you'd be hit by lightning, which would be a very stupid thing to do, you could do that by simply going on the top of a hill with a big metal rod during a lightning storm. Now, of course, you don't want to do that. But what are the chances that you might get struck by something that would make you feel very much alive? Like a stroke of inspiration, for example. My guess is that you have already been struck by inspiration many times in your life. Maybe you were taking a shower or listening to music or just looking out the window when all of a sudden, ping! Inspiration struck you and you had this wonderful idea of something that you wanted to do. Can you remember the last time that you were struck by inspiration and how that made you feel? You may have been inspired to solve a problem or paint a picture or create a meme or write comedy. But whatever you did or wherever your talents lie, that creative process is so much fun. And that's what makes you uniquely you. So rather than wait for inspiration to come and to strike us randomly, wouldn't it be great if there's something that we could do to attract inspiration? You know, sort of like holding up a lightning rod and letting it strike you when you want it to happen. Well, we've discovered a few lightning rods for creativity, and we'd like to share those with you. Now, if you're thinking, I'm not the creative type, consider that creativity is a natural part of our DNA. In fact, it's one of the most pleasurable parts of being human. So my favorite lightning rod for creativity is putting myself in positions where I see things from a different perspective. So, for example, my most creative position is when I'm lying on my back on the floor, just staring up at the ceiling. Somehow that's when innovation sort of strikes for me. One of my greatest joys as a professional musician has been to travel around the world playing concerts, just the way professional athletes travel to play games. In fact, athletes and musicians have so much in common that I once created a whole show just about that. There was one time when I went to Hungary. Now that's, I don't even speak Hungarian. I don't even understand one word of Hungarian. So this was very new. And I was walking down the street and I heard this violin playing that was also playing sort of in a musical language that I had never heard before. And it was so exciting because sort of at the beginning, there was a violinist who was just playing a famous gypsy tune. And at first it just kind of sounded like the violin was crying or whining, like, And I just loved that style because it just sounded like so natural, somebody sort of crying or singing. Now, you'd assume that this sort of iconic csárdás Hungarian music was written by a Hungarian. Not true. It was written by an Italian, and not even a famous Italian like Vivaldi. No, it was written by an Italian that otherwise was quite insignificant as a composer. His name was Vittorio Monti. So how did that happen? Well, I think that it was like this, that Monti went on vacation to Hungary and he just came across a folk band that was playing this wonderful Hungarian folk music, and he heard these rhythms, the csárdás, and it inspired him because it was nothing like he had ever heard before, and he dashed off this csárdás and it has become world famous. And so we'd like to play that for you.
Have trips with your family ever inspired you? Did a family vacation inspire you to write a story or paint a picture? Or did attending a college or professional sporting event inspire you to run harder or practice your free throws? If yes, you've experienced inspiration.
The beginning of the creative process starts with a source of inspiration. Inspiration comes from many different places, from many different people. I get the most inspiration from other artists. Since before I could remember, I was given the opportunity to hear some of the world's greatest musicians playing all around me. Having heard all this wonderful music, I was inspired to try out the piano. Something I was too young to appreciate was being taken to the symphony every weekend by my mother. For me, those 2 hours were just too long, so naturally, I fell asleep every time. But since I really do love this music and would want to share it with others, I created Cardenes Productions, whose goal is to make music more interesting, immersive, and accessible to all. In fact, I'm serving as producer of this video. When I first start making a video, I will sit down and just listen to a bunch of music, whether that's orchestral or piano 4 hands, piano 6 hands, that's always very cool. And I listen with non-critical ears. If there's a piece that really catches my attention, I will go back and see maybe there's an arrangement for piano 4 hands, or maybe I can even arrange it myself so that it can sound really good on this piano and I can play such beautiful music.
another musician who used other artists as their source for inspiration, very famous, was John Williams, who wrote the soundtrack to Star Wars, various other famous films. In these clips, you can hear the similarities and where he drew inspiration from these other composers. While John Williams may have taken inspiration from other composers, it was his years of practice and countless hours composing at his piano that led him to be rewarded with 25 Grammy Awards and 5 Academy Awards. Inspiration is essential. But as Thomas Edison once said, genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. As my sister will explain to you, inspiration and doing the work go hand in hand.
When was the last time you encountered a big problem? And what did you do about it? Throughout the history of humankind, problems big and small have inspired people to come up with creative solutions. One example of a great creative solution to a problem is this amazing double-action pedal harp, invented in 1801. Now, the origins of the harp go way back to 3000 BC, when hunters realized that their bow strings made different pinging sounds. And the looser the string was, the lower the pinging sound, and the tighter the string was, the higher the pinging sound. And I have an example here to show you all. Here's my rubber band, which is going to be my bowstring. Let's take a listen. This is a looser string. Now I'm going to tighten it and see what you hear. It's higher, isn't it? Later, around 1000 BC, the Bible tells a story of the young David who would play his lap harp to soothe King Saul to sleep when he wasn't able to sleep at night. By 1600 AD, as music became more complex, people started inventing the lever harp. And here's why. Listen to this and tell me what you hear. Yes, there was a wrong note in there. That was an F instead of an F sharp, which is why it sounded a little bit off. That's because a harp is like a piano with only white keys. There are no extra strings on the harp for sharps and flats, unlike the piano, which has black keys for sharps and flats. So the solution, like a hunter's bowstring, was to tighten the string with a lever to make it sound higher. Problem solved! Now, a lever harp would work just fine if I was playing music that was relatively in one key with very few sharps or flats. However, if I wanted to play really complex music with lots of sharps and flats, that would take a lot of flipping of the levers all the time, and I would probably have to grow an extra set of arms to be able to maneuver that. So that's a big problem for harpists. How do you think you would solve it? Well, in 1801, a man named Sebastian Erard had the idea of moving the levers from the top of the harp to the bottom of the harp so that you can play them with your feet. I have 7 pedals, one for each note of the scale. Let's take this D string for example. Now to play that D, my pedal was on the middle setting. When I press the pedal down, it tightens the string, and guess what happens? Yes, the pitch goes up to a D sharp. Now, let's take it back to D, and then loosen the string by putting it on the high setting. What do you think happens to the pitch? Yes, it goes down to a D flat. And the same is true for all of the other strings as well. I can adjust these pedals to really cool configurations to make the glissando sound really interesting. That's what the harp is famous for. Let's try another one. As cool as that sounds, it's a lot more complicated to be playing with both hands and both of your feet as well at the same time. Times and the constant evolution of music throughout the centuries, the harp has come such a long way and has been reinvented over and over again to finally conclude at the double action pedal harp.
Now, I'm not going to lie to you. There is a difference between having the inspiration to create something and then actually doing it. Now, any creative knows that there are going to be lots of bumps along the way. We have this vision of what we want to do, and yet we have sort of limited technique. And so any songwriter will tell you that they stumble over their lyrics and go back and forth and erase painstakingly until they come up with just the right thing. And composers will probably, you know, trash many of their pieces before they find just the right notes that express what they want. And it's the same thing for us as musicians playing their music. We're going to rehearse and practice and improve what we're doing and refine it so that we can express it in a way that we feel is most authentic to ourselves.
What have you done to make something better in your writing, in your art, your music, sports, or outdoor activities? And how do you feel when you've accomplished it? Here's a performance of Jules Massenet's Meditation. As you listen to this music, think to yourself, how does it make you feel? Makes music so meaningful.
my creative process starts out with practicing. Before I even set up this camera, these lights for a video, I am practicing for 3, 4, sometimes 5 months for just one short recording. This is what really takes up the most amount of time in my creative process. In those months that I am practicing, I am doing something very different than what many other musicians are doing. Because I'm playing more than one person's part at a time, sometimes I'll have to record myself playing one part, and then listen to that and record myself playing another part to make sure that they really line up, whereas some other artists only have to practice their own part. So after practicing for these months, I will go to my piano and I will set up just a bunch of different shots. So the filming part for me does not take all that long. It takes me about a night, sometimes 2 nights to shoot. This is because all the hard work has already been done. So once I've finished shooting, I go to the editing stage. And this is when I really get to be creative with the visual part of this project. I really try to make the video reflect what is happening in the music. Whether that's really fast music, you get a lot of shots of the going all over each other and jumping from here to there, or if it's very slow, doing a nice fade, which helps me convey the meaning of the music to you.
So my creative process was the process of recording my college audition videos. So after I applied to all my colleges, they asked me to send in videotapes of me playing the repertoire that they had asked for. And so what they're looking for in those videos is they're looking for accuracy of notes, they're looking for potential, and they're looking for musicality. It's simply my job to play the best that I possibly can. However, the recording process is not as easy as it seems. Believe it or not, even just turning on the camera when I'm starting to record makes me nervous, even if there's no one in the room. Recording can also be very frustrating. It usually takes me between 2 and 15 times to record a video that I'm very proud of. I remember once when I was in the middle of my recording process, I had just recorded one of the best videos and I was really excited. I thought I was all done. And I look over to see that the camera had not even started recording. I was so upset and I was so frustrated. The biggest challenge for me was just to accept failure sometimes. You know, the recording process is not easy and you really have to get used to not doing well all the time. So my mom and I compiled an outtake video, which are different clips from failed recordings that I had done. So, take a listen and tell me what you notice.
Oh, come on! Gosh. Give yourself a little more love.
What did you notice? I noticed that at the very beginning of the video, up until about halfway through, I was very negative, kind of talking down to myself. I wasn't really happy with how the recording process was going. And then halfway through the video, I had finally gotten a really good take. And I was super excited about it. And you can see at the second half of the video, I'm a little more nice to myself and I add a little humor in there. A little more lightheartedness in the midst of failure. Throughout this recording process, I realized that patience was really the most important part, and I needed to learn a lot from it. Finally, after the long recording process, I had submitted all of my videos to the colleges that I applied to.
You know, sometimes I envy painters or writers, and most other creatives who are able to sort of craft their art and then till it looks just the way they want it to, you know, and then they put it out to the public and it's just perfect. But you know, for actors and musicians, there's no guarantee that it's going to come out just the way we want to, because it's a live performance. And anybody who's walked out on stage will know that you get a little nervous, your hands get cold, maybe a little sweaty, the lights are in your eyes. All these distractions can affect your performance. And so you never really know. So that's something that we work on overcoming. Now, the way that I do that is I think very deeply about the music and what I want it to express. And I think about you, my beautiful listeners, and how I would like it to make you feel. And then that magically takes the focus away from my self-consciousness, and it allows me to play the music the way I'd like to. So this piece that I'd like to play for you is by William Grant Still. This composer went to a museum and he was struck by inspiration when he saw a sculpture of a young boy with kind of a cap kind of halfway off his head, and it was just very playful. And so I want this music to be sort of energetic, teasing, a little bit rambunctious. And so give this a listen and see if that comes through in our performance.
The last part to creating a video like this is the presentation. I upload it to YouTube, I schedule it for the next morning, I normally do a Sunday morning. When I upload it to YouTube, I'm not looking for the most amount of clicks or the most amount of views, because I'm not making it necessarily for other people. I would love to share music and very cool ideas with others, but I'm doing it to create something. As any writer will tell you, in order to make a really good story, you have to get all the bad stories out. So in order for me to make a really good video, a really good piece of music, I have to get out all the bad recordings, all the wrong notes. And one will come as you learn to create. I'm only 16. I've been doing videos like this for about a year. I still have a lot to learn. In fact, the video that I'm making now is the first larger video that's gonna have a whole lot of moving parts and storylines, and I hope that you enjoy this one. Here are snippets of the Dumkey Trio I created while putting this video together. ¶¶
Finally, after the long recording process, I had submitted all of my videos to the colleges that I applied to. Out of all of them, I am most proud of this video. Most meaningful performances have been when I've had the opportunity to play for people who are suffering from cancer, trauma, or grief, and seeing the powerful healing effect that music had on them. This is what inspires me to want to become a professional musician. Now, as I head to Manhattan School of Music, I know that I will need to spend hundreds of hours practicing so that I can become a better musician and achieve my dream of becoming a harp soloist at the highest level. I hope that my performances will bring beauty into people's lives and also uplift those who are struggling with emotional or physical challenges. After a long 2 months of waiting for results, I finally got the results. I had gotten accepted to every single school that I applied to, including my top school, Manhattan School of Music, where I was awarded the Presidential Award Merit Scholarship. I am so excited to be studying in New York this fall.
Thank you for joining us in our home. We really enjoyed this time with you. We hope that you'll continue to seek inspiration throughout your day.
That you'll find the patience to keep on trying when it's difficult.
And that you'll find the courage to put yourself out there and share your creative work with others.
And who knows, your work may be the spark for someone else's creativity.